On this special edition of Cana and Mike's Movie Night, it's Mighty Morphin Power Rangers, the movie. It's Morphin time! Hello, everybody, and welcome to Cana and Mike's Movie Night. I'm Mike.
And I'm Cana.
And this is a special Monday edition of Cana and Mike's Movie Night. We are preempting RQR plays this week because this is Power Rangers Week on the ECS Network. The new Power Rangers movie comes out this weekend, and all across the ECS Network, every day this week, we have another Power Rangers-themed episode of all the different ECS shows. Tomorrow's episode of DenziCaster will be we're preempting our Kamen Rider Decade run, doing Green with Evil from Mighty Morphin Power Rangers. The Chopsaki Cinema guys on Wednesday, our old time slot, they are going to be doing The Four, which is sort of a Chinese superhero team movie. And then it's going to be Turbo, a Power Rangers movie, coming up Thursday on DenziCaster. And I honestly don't know what the 8-star anime crew is doing, but they tell me it will somehow be Power Rangers-ish. We'll find out on Friday, I suppose.
I'll probably wear a Power Ranger shirt, let's be honest.
I think it's a toss-up between Ronin Warriors and Voltron, which are both very Power Rangers-ish shows. So
you can tell whose week this is.
It's your week. It's your week, folks. The Power Rangers fans around the world here on the ECS Network. It's going to be cool. The new Power Rangers movie comes out this weekend. It's from the folks at Lionsgate are the ones putting it together. I mean, that's...
Oh, good. Another movie that I will watch with as much attention as I did with, what, Godzilla?
So, Lionsgate is like Divergent and that series of films that you seem to like a good deal. I mean, we own two of them.
Yes.
But we'll wind up owning the third one.
Eventually.
Anyway, folks, we are turning back the clock to 1995 for Mighty Morphin Power Rangers, the movie. The first attempt at a Power Rangers major motion picture in the United States. To put everyone here in the proper time frame for this, I was in 8th grade when this film came out, about to become a freshman in high school.
And I was in... I had just passed 5th grade and was going to be entering into 6th grade.
So, this one's been around
a while.
Wow, that
makes it sound like you're so much older than me.
Well, I'm 3 years older than Cana, so it's not a great deal older.
Yeah, but 5th grade to 8th grade.
Yeah, when you put it in school terms,
well,
it
when
we
put it in school
more.
Terms, it just sounds like forever.
So, this film, starring the cast of Mighty Morphin Power Rangers, the television series for the most part, it stars Jason David Frank, Amy Jo Johnson, David Yost, Steve Cardenas, Karen Ashley, and Johnny Young Bosch, as, of course, the Mighty Morphin Power Rangers themselves. I'm kind of glancing at the back here real quick. Jason Arvey and Paul Schreier, Bulk and Skull, they're both in the film. And Paul Freeman is playing Ivan Ooze, the bad guy of the film. This movie is a strange animal in Power Rangers as a whole because it's not part of Power Rangers canon. If you actually watch the television series, this movie came out between seasons 2 and 3. Season 3 is when they introduced the ninja zords and the ninja powers and all that good stuff. And this movie was supposed to be the origin of the ninja powers. And then they scrapped it. So, and had a...
I can understand why.
You really can, kind of, folks, when you watch it. But they scrapped it to come up, and there's Morgan the movie cat. They did that to come up with a alternative origin for the television series that completely replaces everything that happened in the movie. So as we do here on Cana Mike's Movie Night, just a very brief synopsis. I mean, it's Power Rangers, so the story is not overly deep, unlike the cat's claws as they are digging into my knee. So
that tells you how much that Morgan liked the movie.
All the claws. So
is that a voting method? All the claws?
No.
None of the claws?
No.
Half the claws?
No, it is not a valid voting method on...
Morgan, what do you think of this movie? Is this all the claws movie?
Baby, not while she's sitting on my crotch. So...
I thought this was a kid-friendly episode.
I didn't say kid-friendly. I mean, the new Power Rangers movie is PG-13. This one, on the other hand, was G. And that was PG. I tell a lie. This was a PG movie.
Probably because of violence.
Probably because of the nut shot at the end of the film.
Spoilers. Oh, yeah.
So, the basic plot of the movie is this.
But they told you only to do it
in case of emergency. The basic plot of the movie is this. The Power Rangers are in Angel Grove, which in this case is played by the city of Sydney, Australia. Unlike it being a nondescript California town in most episodes of Power Rangers. The Rangers wind up having to try and stop a being called Ivan Ooze. Ivan Ooze is this millennia-old monster, wizard, big bad that has been trapped by Zordon thousands of years ago in an egg.
I'd be pissed too.
Yes. Beneath Angel Grove, along with his ectomorphicon titans, basically his Zords that he was trying to construct to take over the world. His prison is accidentally unlocked by a bunch of construction workers, or at least dug up. Zed and Rita release him, and in the thought process that he will wind up serving Lord Zed, that's not the case. He winds up taking over, imprisoning Zed and Rita in a snow globe, and becomes the big bad for the movie. Winds up taking out the command center, and the Rangers have to travel to some faraway land to find new powers in order to save Zordon's life and defeat Ivan Ooze once and for all. That's the basic plot of the movie. It is a 95-minute Power Rangers episode in that regard. So, let's talk about the film. We will start with the story, such as it is. This was not her first choice for a movie for us to watch this week, but...
This is the first time I've ever seen this movie.
Yeah, because you...
Growing up as a child, my mom forbid us from being able to watch this movie. We weren't allowed to do a lot of things that normal kids did, so I'm a little bit odd. So I was almost 10 when this movie came out.
Right.
So I'm 22 years short of having seen this at the right age.
But now you and your siblings and cousins loved Power Rangers growing
Yes,
up.
We watched the TV show.
Mm-hmm. Which is far cheesier than the movie.
Probably if I watched the TV show now, I would probably give it just as much of a hard time, if not more, that I gave this movie with my first viewing.
The story of the movie, when I say it's a 95-minute episode of Power Rangers, it really is a 95-minute episode of Power Rangers.
The lines. I could started to guess them before they happened, and I was fucking right.
This is the first time for those of y'all playing the drinking game at home. The writing is cheesy. It's full of the one-liners that you expect from Power Rangers. The acting is highly suspect by anyone not named Paul Freeman. So, the three best actors as of this movie when it came out are Paul Freeman, who plays Ivan Ooze, and then Balkan Skull, because they were actually classically trained actors. Or were in the process of becoming sane. So, there you go. That's your best acting in the movie.
And considering the fact Balkan Skull was barely in a third of the movie.
If that. They weren't part of it.
They were minuscule, but they helped save the day.
Yeah, they actually, if I recall correctly, they play a bigger role in the Turbo movie.
Please don't make me watch it.
No, that's on Denzi Caster this week, sweetie. You're not on that show.
I know, but please don't make me watch it.
I'm not going to make you watch it.
Okay.
Anyway.
Thank you.
It is a better movie, though, folks. Spoilers.
I can't take any more Power Rangers.
You're going to hate this weekend.
I am.
At any rate. Amy Jo Johnson and David Yost were probably known as the two best actors on the show for quite a while. They
lost it during the movie.
They're frankly not bad in the film. To me, the worst of the hero actors, and God help me, I'll catch heat for this later. Jason David Frank in this movie is atrocious, as Tommy, which is kind of sad when you stop to think that he had been playing the part as of this movie for 2 years. Over 100 episodes of television.
It's because they had a bigger budget. He just phoned it in.
I don't know if that was the case. Let's talk about the visuals in this movie. This movie is one of the films you can point at as the definition of visually stunning, at least until you get to the last 30 minutes. The movie, they had a budget. This really is, if for better or worse, this is what Mighty Morphin Power Rangers looks like with a budget. The costumes are very different from the television series as far as the material. The TV show obviously used spandex. The movie uses plastic molded armor so that it actually looks like armor, and it gets the point across. It looks reminiscent and very much inspired by the television series, but it looks like actual armor heroes might wear. They don't bring in any of the weapons from the television series except Saba. Everyone else gets some sort of new gimmick. I've always said these shows and movies like this are nothing if not toy commercials. So you gotta sell new toys. The bad guy costumes all get revamped. It's a new Lord Zedd design, a new Rita design, a new Goldar design.
Yeah, but Rita's wasn't that far off. I mean, literally, it just looked like there was a slight change in coloration and...
better materials.
And better materials.
So, I wouldn't be shocked to find out that that they used that Rita costume later on TV. That's another thing. They upgrade all the sets. It's a new command center. It's a new effect for Zordon. It's a new Alpha 5 costume. And none of the new effects, none of the new sets, they had a new throne room for Lord Zedd. None of it made it to the television series after this. They didn't get to take any of it with them, which I always thought was surprising. Another TV series turned movie that we've discussed here before was Batman from 1966, which she liked, I think, around as well as she liked
this. I liked
it
better than this.
Fair enough. But at least they had the good sense that everything they made for the movie, they got to keep for the TV show. Not the case here. But the locations are beautiful. The costuming is well done. There's nothing visually bad about the movie except the CG, which is horrible.
It's CG from 1995. It was probably impressive back then.
No, it wasn't. I remember it in 95. It was terrible then.
Well, I wouldn't know. I didn't. Oh, sorry.
1995. I want to say Babylon 5 was around then, which was a sci-fi TV show. I might be wrong. I might be slightly off. There was better CG than this in 95. Period. Dot. End of story. It simply was. We are now hoping that Duncan the Dancing Kitty does not disrupt our taping. Pardon me. There she goes. Okay. Apparently all I have to do is lean up to scare the cat off. The Zords in the movie...
Oh, the kitties.
Yes, the Zords in the movie are horrible. Absolutely horrible. Especially if you know what they're supposed to look like from the Japanese show / the third season of Power Rangers, because they don't even look similar. So there's that. One thing that... aside from the costuming, which I do think the costuming and the wardrobe for the movie is very well done, another thing that I will call this movie out for that I think is very well done is the soundtrack, because the movie actually has a fairly impressive soundtrack. It's not all typical Power Rangers fare. It's not the stuff that they use on TV. You've got Devo is on the soundtrack. Kung Fu Fighting, which you kind of wonder why they never used that in a Power Rangers show or anything like that before, because they didn't have money. Free Ride is on the soundtrack. This has a classic rockish soundtrack. She's going to hate this comparison, folks, but it went through my mind when I was watching it. This has a soundtrack that actually reminded me a lot of Guardians. Guardians of the Galaxy.
I'm not going to deny that it has a good soundtrack. But let me tell you, script writers were a whole hell of a lot better on Guardians than this. I'm sorry. You can write a good kids movie without making it so difficult to swallow that literally for the fathers they have to put a woman in a bikini and loincloth.
more or less, that there's what is would affectionately be referred to as the For the Dads moment of the movie. Hello, Duncan. The For the Dads moment in the movie is when they do go to the planet Phaedos to unlock the great power, a.k.a. the ninja powers. And they come across Dulcea, which is literally a woman in a bikini and loincloth. She looks like she walked off the set of Conan the Barbarian. Okay, so we know the writing's bad.
Oh, God, yes.
We know the acting is bad.
Yeah.
We know that you found the soundtrack acceptable. So, except for the soundtrack, name one thing about this movie that was good.
That's not fair.
Yeah, it is. It's perfectly fair.
You're not going to like the answer.
Move, cat.
One thing that was good. Not counting the soundtrack.
The fact that they all jumped out of planes at the beginning.
What, you were hoping they'd die?
I was hoping the movie would end quickly.
I told you before it started it had a 95-minute runtime. Try again.
Damn it. Why?
Because the movie has to have a redeeming quality to it somewhere.
If there's a redeeming quality, then I'd want to watch it again.
No, there are plenty of movies that have a redeeming quality that I have no interest in seeing a second time.
There were fireworks at the end.
Okay, so she's not going to give me an actual...
No, I really can't think of something that's...
You found no redeeming qualities in this movie whatsoever.
No!
Wow. Okay. Bottom line, and I've said this before about movies like this, it's very simple. It's not a good movie.
No.
It's not even remotely a good movie. In my opinion, it is fun.
But so, you like Power Rangers yes, as an adult.
Yes, I do. And see, I liked it as a kid.
But see, for me, I'm a little bit different. I grew... Oh, frick. She spilt the water.
Well, luckily it's just water, sweetie. So, you're a little different.
I grew out of my Power Ranger phase at about 6th grade.
So about the time the movie came out.
The movie came out before I went into 6th grade. Either way, I grew out of it around 6th grade, 7th grade.
Okay. What is the single worst thing about this movie to you?
The script.
So you're...
The storyline just kind of was off and wrong and just... Ugh.
Who did write this hunk of junk anyway?
Whoever it was should be, you know, strung up.
John Camps and Arnie Olsen. I've never heard of those two jabronis.
There's a reason why.
Probably. For me, the best part of the movie, it's, like I said, for better or worse, it's a 95-minute episode of Power Rangers. The worst thing about this movie, to me, even worse than the CG... And you can connect it to the writing in some way. Not only do I think Jason David Frank did not do his best work in this movie, and he had plenty of episodes of the TV show where he was good, not great, but good.
Decent.
I would give him a little bit better than decent. But in this movie, he's not even that. And in this movie, they almost go out of their way. It's something I never really noticed until watching it this time. It's as if they go out of their way to make Tommy the Mary Sue of the movie. Where the Rangers cannot get out of a situation if Tommy is not there to bail their ass out for the entire film.
Well, Kimberly can't even save herself.
Yeah, and she is, in this movie, in many ways, she's the number two for the team, because...
Well, she's the damsel in distress.
In the Power Rangers television series, originally, and it's a carryover from Japan, the Red Ranger's usually the leader. In the American show, when they introduced the White Ranger in season two, they made him the leader, and Red basically becomes his lieutenant, the deputy, the second in command. In the movie, that role falls to Kimberly, for the most part. But for the entire film, any action scene where the Rangers get in trouble, it's up to Tommy to save the bloody day. So
except for that one moment where Aisha was just, I have enough, let's knee the guy in the gonads.
Yeah, that's the one and only time, and it's the end of the movie. And it's Aisha that winds up bailing them out at the last minute. But the first fight scene of the movie, where we see them as Rangers fighting Ivan Ooze's Gumps, Tommy's the one that finishes the fight and bails everybody out. When they wind up going to Phaedos, every single time they get bailed out, it's Tommy doing it. He comes in for multiple Deus Ex White Rangers in the Zord fight towards the end of the movie. So I really do not care for the fact that in a franchise where the whole premise is they are a team and they have to function as a team, that one character winds up being the standout hero. It would be like watching the Avengers and the only character that gets any big hero moments is Captain America for the entire film.
I thought of a moment that I liked. Okay. It's not a redeeming moment.
But it's something you liked.
It's something I liked. I like the frog comment.
Okay. There's a scene in the movie where they're getting their animals and Johnny Young Bosch as Adam gets pissed because he's the frog. And Dulcia tells him, of course you're the frog. You're like the one that you kiss and get a prince. Not that it has any use in combat or anything like that, because she, you know, rattles off what all the rest of them, you know, the agile crane and the cunning wolf and
the strong,
the mighty bear and the intelligent ape and the winged lord of the skies, the falcon. And then there's the frog. One of these days, I hope they make a cat zord.
It'll be shaped after Duncan because it's going to terrorize human rights.
So, we'll wrap this one up, baby. What do you think? I'm asking as a formality. I already know the answer.
I'm going to give you two votes.
Okay.
My fifth grade self would have put a cell phone down, even though really cell phones didn't really exist much when I was in fifth grade.
It would have been receiver down.
That's right.
Okay.
But as an adult, it's a cell phone up.
Okay. The movie has actually gained more charm for me over the years than it did as a kid. I have discovered a flaw in some of our new furniture arrangement. My 8-year-old self probably would have said that this was a cell phone up, because it was so different than the television series that I didn't care for it much at the time. Now I give it a cell phone down. I actually will occasionally put it in and watch it from time to time.
How in the fuck did we end up being flip-flop?
Well, part of it for me is nostalgia at this point. But the other thing is that for many, many, many years, if you wanted to own anything Power Rangers on DVD, this was it. This was what you got. Up until Shout Factory and Lionsgate started releasing the seasons of Power Rangers on DVD, which I am slowly collecting, this and the Turbo movie were all you would get. So, I've watched numerous times over the years. You'll never find it in a Power Rangers box set. You can blame Fox for that because they won't give up the rights to it for anyone else to do anything with it. But I'm sure you'll find it on sale at your local video store soon because, you know, I'm sure Fox will love to capitalize on the upcoming Power Rangers movie by releasing the old ones on DVD again. So, regardless of whether it is ourselves 20-some-odd years ago or if it's ourselves now, the score remains the same, one cell phone down. So, just depends on which one of us is giving it. So, as you guys may or may not have noticed, Cana and Mike's Movie Night is on hiatus from the channel. We're taping new episodes and all that, getting geared up for a next run. And we'll wind up on a new day of the week here on the ECS Network. Chopsaki Cinema has taken over Wednesdays. Josh, Will, and the gang are over there, so please check them out and show them some love, as well as all the other great shows here on the ECS Network. And don't forget to check us out over at cafepress.com. /ECS Network and help support the channel. Buy yourself a t-shirt, mug, you name it. We've probably got it sitting over there. It certainly does help us out here on the channel. Thank you very much. Share, like, subscribe. And until we see you again here on the ECS Network, it won't be too far away. I'm Mike.
And I'm Cana.
And we'll see you on Cana and Mike's Movie Night.